My name's Colin. I've been trading for like the last 8 months, 9 months in the NFT space. I don't know exactly how long anymore because it feels like forever, but it's really not. I'm particularly like a short-term trader for the most part, and I trade based off of momentum and any type of short setup that I can see based off of mint out or just volume in general. I don't like holding for the long term, but that's just me.
All right, so most of you know me, or you would know me by now. I'm Hellequinnnn, one of the co-founders of Llamaverse. I do a bunch of the background development for Llamaverse. All right, Colin, what do you want to talk about? How are you feeling about the market so far these last few days?
I mean, looking at the charts, we're in a really bad spot.
It's rough, isn't it?
The last 2 days have been our lowest days in volume-wise since December 8th is what I can see on the chart. I can open it up for a wider view.
This is when, you know, people and project consolidate and stronger. I mean, it's a bit rough. A few metas have already died in the last few days, as you would expect. Just mints are not doing so well. That's just across the board for all projects. Majority of floors have dipped, including the blue chips. It's looking a bit rough, but again, it's very likely due to external conditions, which are widespread, not just in the NFT space and the crypto and just general markets. You know, S&P 500, all that shit is going down. Futures are going crazy. Commodities are going insane. Oil reached a 13-year high the other day, or I think today actually. So yeah, this war is not doing anyone any favors, any traders. But
yeah, that was terrible. I saw that.
The war is terrible. Obviously, there's a lot of very saddening videos and information coming out. But hopefully, it is resolved sooner rather than later, and I can assure you the economic impact of it will be widespread. So yeah, that's kind of the situation we're in. But again, there's been numerous conflicts throughout time, and usually the markets come back stronger, or there's a period of downtrend for a while, which I believe we'll be entering after pretty reasonable recession is forming, in my opinion. But that is, you know, quite a bleak outlook. I would say you never know what can happen.
Yeah, we're seeing, like, what's weird is a lot of people are transitioning because obviously liquidity got ripped out of the market from a lot of these big old mints.
Yeah.
Sitting at like 0.25 and 0.5 mint prices, and Pixelbon being one of the biggest at like 70 million overall volume off of mint.
Yeah.
We're starting to see an uptick in people looking into buying undervalued projects. So obviously one that most of us have the most involvement in is us. We have had a pretty good uptick in prices. We're at 1.1 the other day. Now we're sitting around 1.6, hit an all-time high of 1.8 yesterday. So obviously people are looking to put their money into more stable projects where they have a long-term value in.
I think people are realizing that, you know, chasing the hype is not always the best case. Obviously, everyone knows, you know, there's always good flips if you can get the whitelist and stuff. But I'm pretty sure, like, people are not buying, like, idiots on secondary right after mint on most of these projects, which is actually a good thing. If you think about long term, the market's maturing. That's why you see a lot of people buying these lower entry projects with actual utility. So, and I mean, there's a bunch of those around, so that's quite good. And a bunch of teams are building, and obviously some are going to give up, but
People are starting to look for that like long-term value. So I think that's where the market shift is going to go. To be honest, I mean, there has been profitable mints and plays within the last 2 days. Looking at like Wandaverse right now, sitting right around 4K sales in the last what, 4 hours they have? We had, let's see.
I mean, yeah,
Like
and you can
cyber
see there's
brokers.
yeah, there's a new meta developing on around the Minecraft and NFT worlds, which is a very reasonable meta, I believe, and a sustainable one for sure. Yeah, I mean, I'm just looking at Wonderverse right now. It is doing pretty hot.
Yeah, it had a lot of momentum earlier. I think, especially right now, with the amount of plays that we are seeing, the ones that are going on are going to catch a lot of volume, as there's not much to look at right now. So things
Yeah, and I
like
mean,
cyber brokers is completely dominating the market right now. We're looking around 2x from where Champs called it, which is where I saw it personally. They're at 1.75 from, I think, 0.6 actually. So that's doing extremely well with the volume that we have.
nice optics. But yeah, I mean, again, metas come and go, they develop, people think of realizing that NFT space is basically a bunch of startups, and you can't really bet on an undoxed project promising you this and that and this and that, and then doing nothing in the end. So I
Yeah, I
think
agree with
people
that.
wisening up, and there's always money to be made in any fucking market you're in. There's always
Yeah, I
money.
agree with that 100%. And I feel like that
So
resembles perfectly in Raid Party Fighters and like Mafia, which had a pretty good uptick the last 2 days. Although being called, those are more like reputable projects, right? That have had sustainable long-term value in mind when they're building. Even if you look at things like Antonym, they were sitting around like low 0.5, 0.4. Now they're up to 0.6. Still haven't revealed, obviously, but shows a shift in market sentiment.
I personally sold my Antonym for near the top, because I knew like the market conditions are gonna allow me a cheaper entry if I ever choose to enter. I mean, I am holding very few NFTs right now, so yeah, and it's I mean, like NFTs are quite a risky investment, as they're kind of like startups, as I mentioned, so I don't see many people bringing a bunch of new money in when everyone's bills are going up, inflation is going up, the uncertainty of wars around the corner. So I don't think we're gonna see the good old days of people aping in like idiots for a while.
No more Kevin Punks. You don't like Kevin Punks?
Fuck that.
Yeah,
I would just look away. Like I would open Alpha Sharks, and the tool shows you like mint and like sales, and I'll be Kevin's for like 8 hours, and I'm like, I don't want to look at this anymore, so I just look
that
away.
was bad. That was very bad. I
Yeah.
you could tell that was our very bottom day,
Yeah, that
just
was a
as the
rough
fact
day.
that there was nothing else going on but Kevin.
Yeah, and I mean like in a way that these like hyped mints kind of not doing so well. Or like not some like most projects not minting out is kind of good, and there's a argument there that these scammers and these lazy projects are gonna have to put in a lot of they're gonna have to put in a lot more effort, and they can't get away with like the copy and paste
3D
roadmap of the
art.
copy and paste 3D art that is essentially the same thing, just used over and over again. Which, okay, there might be less liquidity, but there's less bullshit to invest in, so yeah. I
No,
think they kind of
yes.
go hand in hand. It's never like black and white, and if it was black and white, we'd all be fucking billionaires, so
Yeah,
yeah.
I think a good thing that I've been doing recently, especially with all these like the 3D meta and then some of these massive mints that went on, is looking at relative to their mint price, their floor price, and their supply. So if a project's minting out for, say, like 0.3 and they have a 10K collection, then you're seeing, let me see this, do the math here, 3. They're trying to pull in 3,000 ETH, right? So obviously, if a project's trying to pull in 3,000 ETH, they should have some sort of a reason to do so. And I've been trying to really push that recently, as we're seeing these massive mids come out, or not anymore because the market's died down, but we were seeing these massive mints going out, and it seemed like every project was trying to charge the most they could. So I think it's a good thing to look at in terms of building long-term value and what projects are trying to get out of the jump from you. Because things like art projects don't need 0.3 mints and 0.25 mints, as they are typically just art projects with no utility based onto them. So they're just trying to upcharge on the art itself. They're not really building things out. So mint price and overall evaluation as like a seed funding round should be looked at as a company evaluation for these projects.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, I think that's why, you know, these Minecraft meta is coming around now, because it's quite easy for and quick for people to develop their ideas, and you know, there's fucking billions of Minecraft servers with ecosystems that can be adapted to NFTs quite easily, and done successfully, that could be really useful for holders. And I think that's why you know, it's easier entry for projects, but that also kind of introduces an issue that more incompetent developers and more incompetent teams can kind of get away with murder somewhat, as we've seen before. I'm not gonna name any names of incompetent teams, but yeah.
Speaking of that, I think that really showed us not incompetent teams, but projects being built off projects basically NFT Worlds is the first project in my eyes to do it correctly, as there's been multiple successful projects to come from them in the midterm value-wise. We haven't seen what they've actually provided so far yet, but so far they have succeeded in my eyes in projects like Skux and Heroes Galaxy, because they're building on top of an already established project. But what is even more notable there is for the future, when investing, projects that allow others to build on top of them is pretty substantial.
Yeah, it's like kind of like World Wide Web with their mass integration and majority of projects, you know.
Yeah, and then Sappy Seals as well, with integrating other communities into theirs, mainly us.
So these are like the long-term plays, and you know, and I mean, NFT worlds, technically, you don't actually need a world to kind of develop an ecosystem on Minecraft, because it is a demo-day Minecraft, but I think, you know, everyone's NFTs is like, NFT worlds is like a hot trend right now, so everyone's like getting worlds and buying shit, you know. What projects will do with these worlds is yet to be seen. Again, the experience of the project team, the project's team, is gonna come to show, you know, come to light. Because everyone can do a fancy build, but then what?
Yeah, I was gonna just say real quick that there's projects like I think what was the one that we just minted out, the land project, Rovers. Is another one of those projects that
the planets.
Where I think eventually people will end up building on top of their ecosystem and seeing what they can get out of it, as realistically Troverse is very scalable in a sense. And I think that's what I've been looking at recently, like projects that just allow things to build into them and on top of them.
We'll see where the market goes. I mean, it can go lower, you can kind of keep this kind of dead volume for a while and then bounce back, but I mean, I guess it's the external conditions that are going to be the case, going to show everyone. And you know, if we see a big liquidation of stocks and all that shit, you know, NFTs go first in a way.
Yeah, the lowest, like the highest risk asset.
But again, like, it's, as I said, you can make people make you know, money in the old market. So if we buy these high risk assets now, and then, you know, some months down the line, you know, the economic outlook is better, we'll going to always come back, because, you know, once you see how much money can be made here, you're kind of addicted in a way. And if you're smart, you can invest, you know, the same amount of money here that you would invest in a stock and, you know, get way bigger returns. Way bigger returns. Again, it's many things that go into it, and, you know, I think general public's acceptance of NFTs and it's going to play a big part of this.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think those who are buying, not now, but very shortly, are those who are going to be successful.
Yeah.
Not saying short-term trading is impossible to be successful with, but those, obviously, you see with Bored Ape and all these other massive projects, these were not at massive floors right away. It takes time.
I think massive floors are not sustainable. So
you don't think massive floors are sustainable?
Oh, sorry, out the gate.
Oh yeah. It's hype is never a good thing. We've seen that too many times.
Yep.
The hype's got to die off eventually.
So. And it will, because, you know, I think I read someone's, I had this conversation with someone at some point. It was when a project has no utility and hype, its floor can go way higher, just based on pure speculation and FOMO, compared to a project has utility. I mean, it doesn't really matter what the utility is in a way, because... So it does really matter what the utility is, because, you know, you kind of, people peg the NFT's value to the utility, you know. Whereas if there's no utility and just art and kind of like speculation of what the utility is actually going to be, then the price can go way higher. So that's why I think that, you know, shit like Hype Bears and, you know, all of these other stupid mints that went pretty high, stayed high compared to like, stayed high for a while. Just sucked out a lot of liquidity and speculation, you know, compared to like Root Troop, which, you know, has actual utility on a super cheap floor. So, you know, it really depends. I don't think, I have not seen like a super high project with a bit of a shitty roadmap to sustain a high floor. And I mean, I believe even NFT world is not going to keep a super high floor for a super high long time. You know, it's going to slowly, if they don't innovate further and, you know, integration kind of drops off to the next thing, they're probably going to dip a bit as well.
Yeah, they ended up getting up to like 14, right? So
yeah, that was
pure. You already had the dip, you know,
in a way, and the world token.
I think they're moving in the right direction though. With
for sure.
Building out, they've basically cut the gas fees on their token by 80% to allow people to build on top of their game, which almost creates an everlasting cycle of people building on top of it, right?
Yeah, so I mean, you gotta realize that Minecraft is the biggest game in the world, you know, and it is quite easily accessible to people. So, you know, why would you? I mean, I used to play a bunch of Minecraft when I was younger, but why would you, you know, play in a normal Minecraft server where you can, you know, usually have to spend some money or some subscription when you can join a random NFT Minecraft server and, you know, just play and earn stuff?
And, yeah.
You don't even have to enter, technically. I mean, you don't even have to purchase anything, you know. The way we're trying to do Llamascape is, on the line, almost anyone can just join and play and, you know. Obviously, they're not going to have the utility, you know, they're not going to have as much value if they don't have the utility, but it's still accessible to them and still allows them to kind of, you know, still have fun in the game, but, you know, kind of move towards something, some value, yeah. Which you just
get
in a normal Minecraft game server.
Basically, everything within Minecraft that is been built previously is being built and reinvented based off of the fact that now you can play tokens and make and money, yeah, while earning, or
and that's and why, make money. Yeah, and I mean, you can imagine that all it takes is a few kind of experienced server admins that have hosted Minecraft servers to kind of just like take some time, learn NFTs, and, you know, adapt. we'll see that, you know, these successful. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, some, you know, not the biggest Minecraft servers, like the most well-known ones, but like the mid-tier, like ones that get a bunch of players like daily, they move to something similar to these tokens, like NFTs. So I think that'll be a move, and I think that's why NFTs will continue to have some, you know, success.
See, I'm gonna pull up the token power ranking for these play to earn games within NFTs, just so we can get a look at what's performing well and what's not, because it's something that I like to look at.
I do look at that almost daily as well. Yeah, I know we're talking about, let me bring it up as well.
They fluctuate very, very strongly too.
You DM it to me, so we're looking at the same one, like the exact same one.
Yeah, I'll send it to you.
So guys, if you don't know what it is, it's basically a big spreadsheet, like a screenshot of a spreadsheet that tracks all play-to-earn games and their tokens and their values and how much money they make and the break-even amount daily. So it's actually a really useful tool. Yeah, I use the same one, Colin. Actually, Colin, we're probably going to try to do something similar with for Llamaverse with this kind of information. Anyway, yeah, as you can see...
Mecha Apes
is back in play. Then Aether Orcs and Metroverse are back on top. I think they fell off for a while.
Mecha Apes is actually way ahead. Wow. I sent a chart into the Llamacast chat if anyone wants to look at it. But currently Mecha Apes is yielding, in terms of return on investment, almost double the closest token, which is Aetherworks.
Yep.
So it's a pretty big gap. You're looking at 65 days until your break even on Mecha Apes if the token sustains its current floor value. This is a I think this is a max though, if you're like a
not much
max robot within their game.
Yeah. Much liquidity though. In the pool.
Yeah, that could get ripped out pretty fast, depending on who decides to withdraw and who doesn't. But you never know. But
okay,
it's
look it... at that. Bytes has fallen quite a lot.
Yeah, Bytes has fallen a lot. I think that's just because there's at current date no real. Big value behind holding them, unless I'm wrong. Someone please let me know. But before it was you would buy citizens and stuff with the bytes, and obviously currently with the season 2 outer citizens being out, there's really no reason to have the bytes. Or well, not no reason to have the bytes. Obviously there is for the tournament, but
yeah, I mean it's this chart will always fluctuate around, and who knows where it will be in a month's time. I would assume some of these Minecraft games will be these Minecraft based products will be around that chart somewhere.
Ooh, I mean, this is
go on, sorry.
Just an interesting little thing for Aetherworks. Their allies are actually, so their secondary collection is actually yielding more than their Genesis, which is very odd.
I mean, yeah, if you look at the Ugaverse, number 9 and 10 Ugaverse babies are yielding more. Slightly more, but still.
And Creeps has fallen substantially from
yeah.
where they last were. I noticed Lumi had a massive dip the other day, which was...
Someone told me why, but I can't quite recall. But again, these games are not very sustainable long term, I think so.
Yeah. I think even when you look at things like CyberKongs, remember CyberKongs were yielding like, I don't even know the number back in the day.
Stupid amounts.
Yeah, none of that is sustainable as like... People are trying to accumulate as much tokens so they can get the most out of the ecosystem while it's there, and while that starts to dissipate, then the token value starts to drop, as they are technically utility tokens, right?
I mean, yeah, they're always utility tokens, but where are the slotties on this graph? Are they gone?
Slotties was up the other day. They must have fell down really bad. I noticed Habibis is up on that list, actually.
Is it?
Sitting above Wolf Game, Wool Pouches, Kaiju Kings, Cool Monkeys, yeah. Defenders of Dogewood, Sappy Seals, Galaxy Fight Club, Bears Deluxe, which is quite surprising, actually.
A new collection, actually.
Yeah, so to segue into that, there's the BB's drop that they're doing as a stealth launch. Obviously, not really too stealthy, as everyone knows about it now. But
Are they doing a are they generating the oil as well?
I don't know exactly as of right now, because Rymo just kind of like talks around things, but never talks what will actually be a part of it. But I know they're doing a drop, and it's going to be a cheap mint, 5 wallet max, for anyone who doesn't know or anyone who hasn't stayed up the last 5 nights looking for their drop date. But it's been rough.
Yeah, I know people are camping out, but I'm beyond that shit. I don't think I can. I've got too much to do to wait for a Habibi drop or another drop like that. I mean, it will likely be quite a lot of good resale, so if you can catch it. I mean, it's going to get botted to shit, everyone knows.
No,
that,
it's going to get botted very bad. Yeah. It'll get botted really bad. That's what we were just talking about, actually. Botting in the NFT space and how prominent it's become as more people switch over into the space, and particularly how much it can cost to run a bot in this space, which, from what I've been told, is extremely pricey.
Is it?
Yeah, because you have to pay for the proxies, right, for the bots.
Oh, right, yeah, right.
And then you have to pay for the bot itself. And I don't know if anyone is actually selling bots for lifetime usage. I've just only heard of monthly payments and renting bots. So
I doubt anyone would be stupid enough to lifetime sell something like that.
That's well, so these bots do have good resale value sometimes. Depends on how good they are.
Right. I mean, it's up to the projects to care and make it as difficult as possible. Yeah, but but there's money that people are gonna face it. Right, let's do some Llamaverse updates. I mean, we are, I believe, pretty good with updating the community. Llama does do the weekly update. I'll just give you like a kind of slightly boring day-to-day update. So Polygon is still having issues, as most of you probably know and majority of the space knows. So we are delaying our launch of Spit because, you know, we always like to make everything as good as possible, and we're not risking any of these issues coming up to mess up the ecosystem. So yeah, again, Alpha Sharks tools we are going to get for all holders. Static holders are going to have limited usage, but they're going to have most of the main modules, and obviously animated holders are going to have full use. And this is a huge value add because it's a lifetime, essentially, access to a top tier tool that's only going to get better. So I believe people should be really hyped about it. I'll be really hyped about it. So yeah, I mean, that'll be good. Honestly, can't wait to do that. We're developing Llamascape, which is going to be part of our Minecraft metaverse system of multiple NFT worlds. Now we have obviously, we have our first world that's already developed. We're launching a Minecraft server with a unnamed party, which we're going to announce soon. And then we have the spare NFT world, which we're going to make Llamascape on, or the Llama City on. And they're all going to intertwine. You can read about that in the documentation. But, you know, we're working on merch, or, you know, not actually, we're not going to launch anytime soon, but we're working on concept for merch, as you can see on Twitter. sometimes. Yeah, I mean, not much new happening. We're just building and building. We already have plans. Spitbuddies, I'm excited for, but we're not actually developing right now because obviously we need Spit to be out. But yeah, I mean, we're doing good. I believe people are happy. We're reaching all-time highs, as Colin said earlier. Last few days, the value of the boost up again compared to last few days. So everything is going pretty good, I would say, on the Llamaverse side.
Actually, an all-time high on both.
Are we?
Yeah, we well, technically not with the boost if you're speaking old prices.
Yeah, but... Yeah,
but the old prices just translated here, so
yeah.
Technically, on both all time high.
Yeah, that's great. You'd love to see it. You'd love to see it. Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's all coming along well as planned. Obviously, we've added a bunch of stuff, which is you can already honestly some project would slap what we're doing extra on a roadmap and just call it a whole roadmap, but you know, we like to roll to bring in as much utility as possible. Right, let's look at some projects that the community puts in. So if you guys want to drop us a few messages about some names we can look at, projects. SX.37 floor, yeah, Distawapes. What Distawapes are doing the last few days. Let's see if they have a drop or not. Distawapes. I actually spoke to Distawapes team today a few times.
Any updates?
No, we must spoke about getting them some whitelist opportunity for Alpha Sharks and some other stuff. So it's looking at on their 30-day chart. It did have a good amount of sales around the end of February, and it's been a bit of a dip as everything, but it hasn't been too significant. It's looking like the current floor is
no, they're holding up really well.
They're holding, yeah, for this market, they're holding actually pretty well, yeah. I mean, let's look at listings. There's a good amount of listings out there, but they're quite a bit above floor. Sales are coming in, you know, they have a good amount of sales a day. You know, they always get a bit more, but actually looking pretty good, pretty strong.
23, 27.
I mean, they have active. Let's check this.
No, yeah, their listings are actually looking really good. I think they've had an uptick in their listings.
Who's this?
Distawapes. I think they've had an uptick in their listings. I think every project has, to be quite honest. Every project had some sort of uptick in listings. Just as sales keep moving down, people are getting impatient, but completely normal outside of everything else. They're holding up extremely well, which kind of surprises me. I didn't think that Distapes would sustain themselves this long, which they obviously are doing great.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have any myself, and I haven't really looked into their system, but I do know a few members of their team, and they're pretty forward-looking, so they should do well in the long term, I believe. And I mean, you can tell they're holding their floor pretty well. I mean, most similar projects have had pretty significant dips.
BearX. I haven't talked about BearX in forever, so I actually would like to look into this one. I saw we had a BearX trait in our
one, yeah.
Project. Holding up 0.15. 60% staked.
Not bad. I've been developing for a long, long time.
Yeah. Wow. So they're sitting at point, they have like only 130 listed, which is amazing.
That's great. And I've been working for a long time to build out the ecosystem heavily.
And Genesis has only got, let's see how many listed for Genesis. There's only 92 listings for Genesis with a 0.25 floor, and it is extremely thin. Two sales to three, and then it pretty much just gaps up. Actually, let me make sure I'm right on this. Yeah, two sales to 0.3, and then I think it gaps up around 0.4. Yeah, pretty much straight from 0.4 to 0.5. So, long-term-wise, Barracks is pretty strong, to be honest. Kind of forgotten about project. Something like this is exactly what I'd be looking at to buy in the bear market when everything gets really dry, as long as the team continues building, right? As we always talk about.
Yeah, and you guys gotta realize that actual development, while it is pricey, most of these projects have a good amount of money to sustain themselves, even for a bear market with little to no royalties coming through. So if a project wants to build and they have decent volume and decent mint price, they can build. So you guys should be really looking at the teams and what they're doing when you're picking your investments in the bear market, because there's very few excuses about not building for a bear market as far as finances go. Someone mentioned Bears Deluxe. What is Bears Deluxe floor? 0.75. That's not bad. What was their all-time high, Colin, do you remember?
It went up to like 2.5, maybe 3.
2.5. Let me
look at the all-time chart just so we can give an accurate. Actually,
dropping.
Average sale was like 4 ETH on October 6th.
Yeah, I guess it's I guess they kind of fizzled out.
Yeah, so they held like 2 to 3. I mean,
I guess they just didn't bring much new to the table. I'm assuming. I don't know. I haven't looked too deep into them,
looking at their old contract and their old collection, there are 68 listings and still sales going on. Very slow, obviously, because this is their old contract, but they're still selling for 1.5 to 2 ETH ranges, pretty much. I don't know if their migration made it so people are supposed to be on this new contract, which I'm assuming so. Yeah, I think that everything just got transferred over here. But the thing with Bears Deluxe is they're a very strong community-based project, and sometimes these projects lose that original grouping. Remember when we had our old like footing in the space, we had a great community and everyone was super set on the future, and then a little hiccup and prices dropped. It's probably the same thing happening to Bears Deluxe, because we've seen things like that happen to Anonymous and other projects that have continued to build over time. Because I see their honey hives. They're sitting at 0.03 floor. I know they're still yielding pretty well, actually. Let's say this. Yeah, Bears Deluxe is still on the top charts for passive yield. So I don't think much has really changed for them. I think it's more of just like a community dip based off people who want to get in and out of the market.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of people that go to the market right now. Jesus Christ. Someone just mentioned Hate Beast and checked out their floor, and it's unfortunate.
I'd actually, like, checked it out.
Yeah, it's Yeah, it's point four. We actually higher floor than Hate Beast. 2 to 4. To me, Hate Beast was always This is what hype does. This is what hype does to a project. And you know, you can imagine how many people lost money. And look at that. I mean, they had days of, you know, 7,000 volume. You know, 7,000 volume another day. So on the first day and second day, they made like 1.3k ETH, you know, and just from royalties. And you guys gotta realize that's a shit ton of fucking money. So, you know, you just gotta question, what are these teams doing? You
know? I mean, they minted out for what, 0.2?
0.2, yeah. I mean, yeah, 8,000. Let's look at the maths. 0.2 times 8,000.
Looking at like 2k ETH almost. So obviously, like, think about it. If you have that much ETH, you pretty much can do anything.
That is crazy. But I mean, like, they've had 5k ETH from royalties.
Going onto their website, I don't really see much. It's the same website.
They're not doing much.
Launch.
I mean, it's pretty much like, sure, they might be getting into big deals with like big brands and stuff, but like, I take a while. But you have so much money, like, you can do a lot of stuff with that money. Like,
they still have the same trait problems from before, hats through ears.
I think through ears was on purpose, no?
I think it's an issue in my eyes. No hat is supposed to go through an ear. Obviously, it would be hard to make it look correct, right? With a big ear. What are you going to fold the ear up? But in my eyes, I was never really a fan of Hape, as like, I've watched things like Mechaverse go on. I'm sure a ton of other people in here have. And I'm normally the bringer of bad news.
I mean, it's fucking disgusting, man. You have so much money, just fucking do something with it. I know these deals can take time, but like, so much you could do in the meantime. In the NFT
I mean,
space, you can do big collabs.
Put it this way. Carefuru launched much later than Hape did, and they're already organizing good collabs with brands like Hypebeast, I believe it was. So, things could get completed, right? You know what I mean? It's not impossible.
I mean, the only thing I saw was they did, they bought a few vans with, like, big screens on the side to drive around London, like, central London. That's the only thing I've seen them do. So, I mean, you kind of got a question at some point, like, you know. Okay, listen, guys. When you go into a project, and you ask inside project, you know, or you look around, you see, where's this money going? You know, what's being developed with this money? Like, those are questions people should ask, because there's these obscene amounts of volume, like Visible Friends, for example. Visible Friends launched, I don't know how long ago, 30,000 volume. That is 3,000 ETH if their royalties are on 10% trade. Think they are. That is a lot of fucking money. Like, what are they doing? Realistically, it's just a walking fucking character.
You know, see, the thing is, though, that's an art-based project, though. So, sure. You kind of know what you're getting when you get into it. Like, I don't know. I had this conversation a while back with some people over the brand that they've developed, right? Random Character Collective is basically an art-based brand. So they're allowed to never provide utility and keep pumping out these high mint price collections. And for those that like the art, right? And it is very high level art. It's probably some of the best animation art that we've seen in this space so far. The looping is perfect. There's never any mistakes that you can see on the art from what I can tell.
I mean, still though, come on.
Is it worth that much? Probably not. But at the same time, it's high quality, at least. You know what you're getting when you get into their project, and I think that's what makes them a little bit different from others. You know you're going to get some sort of high quality art when you're stepping into their ecosystem.
Bro, don't even give me that argument.
Okay, mood rollers, maybe. But I know people that love mood rollers. So it's different.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Like, looking at Azuki, they're meant to be like a skateboard brand, right? Something like that. All I'm saying is... Fuck those, mate. It's just like...
And then their Bobo collection just dropped, sitting, I think, roughly at about mint price, considering the gas you had to pay to get into one.
Yeah.
0.06.
Jesus Christ, someone swept fucking a billion Azukis just like half an hour ago. Fucking hell.
The Bobo the Bean Farmer, 0.065 floor, 15.1k owners, and I think they're dropping another 15k. So,
yeah, I mean, yeah, I guess. I personally, as an investor, would never invest in shit like that, but, yeah. I'm very, orientated towards investments that would bring me, value in the sense of, something tangible, or something I can use, not, cool art.
See, there's a market for it. I was just looking at this. Let me see.
I mean, there is, but it's just, I guess it's just not for me because, I don't know.
Let's
feel like
walk.
I've never put that much money into, something as, I mean, even right now, I would never spend like 10 ETH on Azuki or 8 ETH on Azuki, whatever the hell it is, even at this, dip. And I might be ignorant and probably lose money, but,
There's a second collection that is ripped through floors, which is Let's Walk. Have you seen it?
I think so.
Just another art-based project, walking animations. They have some pretty cool collabs with Deadfellows, some other projects.
Why is there so few of them?
It's because they're ERC.
I see.
I don't know what tokens these are called exactly.
There's a Power Ranger one.
1155s, so you can have multiple owners.
Pretty neat. I see they've done a bunch of cool collabs, but I mean, I guess it's just not for me. And I think there's gonna be a very recurring conversation on this podcast where I'm pissed off or something, and you're looking at it as a
All right, and then Alex Lander says, artificial intelligence. I absolutely am in love with these, like, small supply collections right now, so I figured I was going to speak on it. Sitting at, like, a 3-8 floor, the animations are amazing.
No idea why I didn't get wireless for that. I literally know that, like, the owners of that project, and I spoke to them for ages, but I don't know why I didn't get wireless. I didn't ask them, I guess.
Shan is like a part owner in them now.
Is he
getting a lot of backing from Gojira? But
guess,
they're absolutely sick.
Yeah, pretty cool. I'm looking at them now. They are fucking really cool.
And then having the low supply, it's like if you bought the one at 2.9, the floor is already 3.5. So, I'm obsessed with these small supply collections. Things like Primal Beast, which I just shared yesterday. It's another 1K collection. It's got a pretty decent roadmap, but really what matters in these like collections is the community and who's a part of it and who supports them and who's there every day, you know? Just like us, our community's probably the most important thing other than the utility we have, obviously. But it goes a long way with the community you have.
Yeah, I mean, it's about time that these low supply projects get abused in the sense of that incompetent projects come up that are literally like not deserve money being put into it, whereas things like artificial intelligence club Kajura and all the other low supplies that are currently out that are pretty good, I think people are gonna start copying them and just print out a bunch of shit. So hopefully the method sticks around.
Plus the thing is, when someone like an owner, right, I think you could speak on this more than anybody, when you're an owner of a project, it's a lot easier to supply and provide things for 300 people than it is for, say, 3,000.
I guess, sure, but like, it just becomes like, with that, it becomes to the point where, you can do it, of course. Like, you see Gujarat, they have the small collection, but they're about to launch a collection which is going to make them like have a bigger number than us, like as far as NFTs and
branching out.
You can see artificial intelligence is called Genesis, so you assume there's gonna be a bigger collection because that's just the natural development of how things work. But I guess that's just their way of going about it, like to launch. But what we did was we just compiled it in one go, and I mean was it the best idea?
In theory,
it's the same thing long term. Like, they're eventually gonna have the same numbers, but I believe that we've provided a shit ton of value, and we've done a shit ton of we've done a good job to differentiate the animated and non-animated holders as far as how much they get and utility wise, and I think it will just become like more and more balanced as we go, and I don't think it's an issue to provide these things, because we've been securing tools and we've been securing collaborations that have been benefiting our whole holder base compared to just a few. And I mean, at the end of the day, it's like, sure, they're always gonna have the initial kind of ability to give a lot of value to people, but if they don't adapt and they can't keep up with the second collection they drop. And I'm not saying Gujarat or Artificial Intelligence Club will have those issues, because I know Shannon and his team are very capable and they do a lot of good shit. But I'm just saying in general, like, if people run into those through that method of growing their project, if they can't provide value and utility to the wider holder base at a base level, then they're running the risk of just dying out, like the small collection dying out and the big one following. So
yeah, I mean, there's much more risk. I agree with what you're saying.
But always limited. If you have 343 holders or 500 holders, you're always limited, all projects need funding, and usually sustained funding comes from royalties, so you kind of projects are incentivized to have bigger collections, so there's more trading going on. But at the same time, smaller collection, some project can have 10k collection do like 20 volume or 100 volume a week, and smaller collections can do like double because they just have higher prices but less sales. But I mean, it's up to the project to balance, and all projects are different, so it really is different. And I mean, like, there's many greedy project owners that get a vast amount of the royalties, and royalties add up. Don't get me wrong, guys, like, looking at some projects make millions and after the fact in royalties, and you can imagine, and I can assure you that many owners just take a bunch of that money. But I think our way of distributing the royalties is very unique. I don't think anyone else does that. And does it hurt a project long term? Potentially, it could have used the money to develop something stronger and bigger. But again, we now have enough finances from the mint to do some really good shit, while we find ways to use the royalties, such as buying all of the metaverse land that we have, and then who knows, in 2 months' time, a new meta can come out, we can catch it early with a bunch of money from royalties, and provide a shit ton of value to all of our holders. So yeah. I mean, you gotta consider that shit like NFT Worlds was, 0.15 for a long time. So if we catch the new trend with like 30 ETH in fucking royalties and buy out like 100 of them, like, it'll be insane, like long term. So
I think our way of using royalties to benefit the community is insane, and with time it will be really useful and a bunch of utility on its own. So I think it's very worthwhile.
No, yeah, I agree with that 100%. That was probably one of the best decisions for long term that the holders, I guess, made by switching from giveaways to not investing, but almost investing in yourselves, right? You're putting money back into what you're already holding.
In the long term, because, you know, it's also like, you know, yeah, I would do giveaways now, and, you know, the holders get the X amount of money, and then they could, you know, sell and then leave, essentially. Or we can reinvest it elsewhere. And if people choose to leave, you know, the what we bought doesn't leave, you know, the new person who gets it still has the utility. So it kind of builds more value in itself. So it kind of increases the floor as well.
Well, yeah, so they get the value based off of if they plan on ever leaving, they get to sell at a higher price. And if they plan on holding and staying, they get the benefits of holding those.
Exactly. So it's like a self-feeding cycle in a way.
Value points.
Yeah. And don't get me wrong, like, we might end up using one amount of royalties not so well and another one really well and just leaving, like, a net positive in the long term. But, I mean, Llamascape literally came from this royalty decision, which I think will be very big value add for everyone. So,
I think it was the right choice.
Personally, and I'll hold to that, you know.
Let's see what they put in here. Kaiju Kings and Forgotten Aether Worlds. Opinions on Kaiju Kings? I think long-term, Kaiju Kings are in a great place, to be honest. And in the future, although they're like adding a lot of extra supply, which isn't normally my favorite thing, they're branching themselves out pretty wide to where a lot of people are given access to their community, which is a good thing for them because a lot more people see them.
They are some very organized motherfuckers over there, you know. They have the famous office that they all, you know, work from. So I'm pretty sure that Kaiju Kings are going to do well long term regardless, and they're always going to be able to adapt to the market conditions similar to how we're trying to be. So I do think that Kaiju Kings is a good investment, but I don't hold any of the main collection. I have a Mutant,
which I just voted, and I'm planning on just keeping long term, just so I can be involved.
They just released their new P2E ecosystem.
Oh shit, really?
Yeah, literally seconds ago. Actually, one minute.
Fuck, let's look at it. Link it, big man, link it. This better pump my bags on my Mutant. Play Mutant, by the way. Alright, let's look at this white paper real quick. Alright, just give a second to read out real quick. Oh, bro, Mutants. Oh, Mutants don't make dick. Fuck. Shit, man. Mutants don't make anything. This seems very, okay.
So
look at that merch. That is clean. Alright, let's look at it from top to bottom. We can spend some time reading this. So you guys, there's a link in the description. I don't know, in the description, in the channel. So it says Kaiju Kings was always more than a PFP project. Our waste economics and Kaiju fusing, our mechanics have developed our ecosystem, and have created a unique tangibility to our kings. So Kaiju Genesis produced our waste. They'll be able to fuse, all of that good stuff. and then they mentioned that they have... Alright, so it looks like you'll be able to switch
There's
out
so
your...
much.
Yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot. It'll be worth to read properly and then discuss it on Thursday, possibly. But it looks like there's a new token, Scale, which Genesis Babies and Mutants produce. It looks like, interestingly enough, if you make your Genesis produce scales, they stop producing our waste.
I think the most interesting part of all of this is they've provided the new token inherent value through their community by allowing you to purchase 300 tokens and instantly gain access to their alpha community through holding an NFT, which is such a good idea.
Yeah, we can probably get into that. There's a bunch of DNA stuff.
Yeah, basically just all... I don't even understand what they're trying to do.
Being alone, that's for sure.
Yeah, and they're basically making a burning mechanism with their token as well by making it so your DNA that you're producing and buying can fail as well.
Yeah. Rooftop Rampage will be made into a mobile game. Nice.
Wish I had liquidity. I'd probably buy. Not saying that's a buy signal, but just because I like them and their ecosystem.
There's probably a bunch of sales happening right now, to be honest.
Yeah, and this perfectly lines up with what we were just saying on how those who keep building and keep providing things for their holders are the communities that sustain long term. So I think this is
sure.
A perfect thing to happen live.
Some interesting stuff, and that merch looks clean. Actually similar to what we're gonna go for, actually, as far as merch look and vibe. Exactly what we're gonna go for, actually. We're actually discussing that label on the sleeve today with Bailey. Or having something on the sleeve, rather.
Yeah, I do like the merch.
Bonus. They're doing referral bonuses as well. This is what we've been doing for quite a long time. With remember back in the day we had the referral bonus or like a referral system. Yeah, they're doing a whole game as well.
Oh wait, no, there is mutant kaijus.
Yeah, of course there is. They're just producing less. Pretty cool. I can see pump coming from this. Yeah, already a sale just now. Do I buy one?
Actually, multiple buys.
Bunch of buys, yeah. Let's look at this. Let's look at Alpha Sharks.
Visual.
pretty clean ones on the floor.
Are you speaking babies or mutants?
Babies. I'm looking at babies. I already have a mutant, so I'm not too bothered. It has been trending pretty well, pretty stable.
Floor is also extremely thin on the babies.
Yeah. Is that why I see? Oh shit, you're right. Why cop on is the question. Maybe? Let's see, is there sales coming in? Probably.
There's only 84 sales to 2E.
Oh yeah? Might be a cop for your boy then. It looks pretty good though. We'll do some more research and read up and then probably cop one.
Alright, we'll move past the kaijus because
yeah,
those will probably go trending for the next like 2 days. As there's not much going on anyways, what do you think about niche projects? So projects that are like basically what I'm trying to get at by niche projects by, so art already, the one that you liked earlier, I would consider that a niche project, like projects that are normally smaller collection size and designated for smaller groups of people, right?
Yeah, I like that. So it's like Enigma. Enigma's a pretty niche project in a way. I do believe it deserves more credit though. Enigma does. For those of you that are not familiar with Enigma, it is a NFT that essentially mines Ethereum for you via mining rig. It's been going on for quite a while. And we provide a wireless opportunities for
Gen 1 and 2, I think.
Is it? Yeah, we did old generations, yeah. Provided for old generations. They're doing pretty well. They're already minting. They're already mining Ethereum and collecting rewards. So I think that's a niche project, and I do like those, and I do think that those can be really good. A specific kind of investing, so I personally see Enigma as a hedge, in my opinion. A hedge, but more like a long-term hold for passive income. And just like for me as a person, an investor, and I do have 40, by the way. So
I have 40?
I have 50 in total. Yeah, I have like 0.5, 0.6 over the supply, like a percentage. Like I have a good amount.
How much are they yielding you well or no?
The whole community voted for a 9-month reinvestment period. So for 9 months, all the money is getting reinvested essentially.
Oh, so basically you earn more over time.
Yeah. So after that, I'm gonna be making at least. I mean, it's all very dependent, but on rough like napkin math, it is like over ETH and a half or more a month. Maybe more. And that's without any external scaling that can happen. And E for the low price level, so.
Have reinvesting built into their project?
Yeah.
That's cool. Do. So basically it's just unlimitedly scaling. They've built a company out of it.
Pretty much. You can actually see it here. I'll send the link. Here. This is the current mining rig. With the current GPUs running, there should be more coming soon. So they're slowly buying more and more as Ethereum is doing pretty well.
Fungi says, what's stopping us from having our own private node, as just like Just Nodes has?
Not much. With some funding. Look into it. But see if we can work out a deal to stay on one of their nodes.
I think that's just one of those niche things.
Yeah, you know? But it's pretty good.
No, I really like Just Cubes because it's more of a... It's more of like a long-term hold. It's something that you don't want to get rid of once you have it, once you see the value that it can provide.
It can bring you a lot of value long-term, so why sell it?
Especially when your whitelist is 2 mints.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's pretty good. I do think that we'll do pretty well, and hopefully we can work something out. Oh, also, someone earlier asked, have you considered collaboration with Project Gojira, or are they too much of a competitor? We don't actually see anyone as a competitor. We're always open to collaborate. And although it looks kind of similar, our utility is kind of diverging separately. So we don't really see anyone as competition. I mean, obviously, people are always going to compare us and kind of make it a competition, but we do talk to them quite often, so there's a possibility of some sort of collaboration down the line. So now we're asking for... you're asking for more opinions on Loveless City Metro Pass. I sold mine pretty fast. I flipped it. I don't know. I didn't do enough research. I just sold a decent flip and volume kind of dying off. So I sold it. Let's see how it's doing right now.
They took a dip momentarily, to be honest, I think. I love their supply, though. I don't know exactly what they're trying to do. It just seems like they're trying to collaborate in terms of art with other people and other projects. So if you like, almost like a Haas, you know what I mean? Haas phases and triple sixes. So basically you hold for the airdrops and then hope the airdrops have some sort of inherent value because the art is done by a reputable person, right?
Someone's saying, ever since I joined Llamaverse, more people ask me about collabs and stuff. Some are easy flips, or some could be easy flips. Is it worth bringing up to Alpha Council? No, so people that deal with collabs is Jack Dave and Bravali. So bring it up to them if they see value in the project long term, or if they see value for our holders, they will look into it deeper. So, but it's always worth to bring up projects to us because we might miss some. So yeah. All right, I think we should wrap it up soon. Pretty good first podcast, first episode. We're gonna get the recording done and probably cut out some bits, make some clips out of it for people that weren't here. But yeah, it'll be good. Hopefully we'll do, we can probably do some face cams and all that good shit in the future. Because Colin is a cutie, so we do get on camera. Yeah. All right, I think we'll wrap it up here for the recording, and then we can kind of chill with the team together.